Hello everybody. In today's video, we will be talking about a few judgments which have come up on certain topics that we have identified for you, including interim release, the external member which has to be on the board of the committee, as well as some one more judgment which we will see over here. So without waiting any further, let's start with the thing. Just to give a quick recap of what have we been doing on the Learn series that has been going on since July with us. We have been basically looking at the whole development of sexual harassment law in India, starting from Vishakha guidelines to the interpretation of law which is happening today on the POSH law of 2013. And in the first session that we had in July, we had discussed a couple of judgments actually. Just to quickly go through them, we had gone to discuss Saurabh Kumar Malik, in which the workplace was identified and the ambit of it was increased. In fact, we have Saurabh Kumar Malik today also, because this judgment was a pretty interesting judgment which had a few arguments which shaped the law as we know today. And one of the arguments which we had picked up in July was the workplace, and today's argument that we are picking up and dissecting and interpreting is about parallel proceedings. We had also seen Punita K. Sodhi's judgment, the test of reasonable women, and how much ever we talk about principles of natural justice, it's just not enough. In the Sardar Vallabhbhai National Institute of Technology versus Ranjit Roy, we had seen about how it is important to share the copy of the complaint, not just the extract, how it is important to let the respondent reply properly to the entire complaint as instead of just taking one statement from this person, which is more like a shot in the dark by the respondent as to what it could be, the issue could be all about. And in our first session, in fact, and today again, we're going to be talking about external member. In Ruchika Singh Chhabra's case, we had seen how an external member needs to prove that the person is actually independent, they are not associated with the employer in any manner, and also have experience in dealing with cases of sexual harassment. The other session that we had was regarding quorum, in which we had discussed Jaya Kotade's judgment, one of the landmark cases which had come from the Bombay High Court. In this judgment, we had basically seen about two sets of reports coming in, and the second and one from the presiding officer, one from NGO representing the NGO member as well as two other members. So the court has seen that there has to be a proper quorum. There has to be one set of reports from everybody. So we had discussed this in our previous session. The other judgment which we sometimes understand, you know, is there a limitation period for an internal committee to take up the matter? And this Dayal Srivastava case of Allahabad High Court had come up when the internal committee did not even exist in the company. So we had seen that how the limitation period got extended till the internal committee had been formed. And of course, in Manjeet Singh's case versus Indraprastha Gas Limited, we had seen how there's a difference between cross-examination and cross-questioning. In this matter, the respondent and the complainant, the IC just let them cross-question each other, which was not a proper modality to hear the matter, and it was violative of principles of natural justice. In M. Rajendran's case, which we had also discussed in one of our sessions where we had spoken about the IC being not comprised of members who are subordinate to the respondent, because there's a likelihood of a wrong decision coming in and unfair treatment and biased treatment coming in. So this laid down the emphasis on how an IC has to be fairly formed and has to have an unbiased attitude. The other session that we had in the third session that we had in August, on August 8th, we had seen another judgment on principles of natural justice, which was this very famous judgment of Delhi High Court, Ashok Kumar Singh, which stressed upon the fact that if a complainant is not okay with dealing with, you know, cross-examination in person, then there can be for questionnaire format for these kind of cross-examinations. And it had gone into various service law matters where question answers were done through questionnaire format, which was exchanged with the IC, and it was in writing instead of the verbal cross-examination. In Shanta Kumar, we had seen that the ambit of sexual harassment had been expanded, and we also saw how in Samriddhi Devi's the proportionality of punishment test was seen. The proportionality of punishment would mean that the act which has been committed, the punishment should be proportional to that act and not reduced out of misplaced sympathy, which was the case in Samriddhi Devi. A superior violating the trust that a junior has in that person is likely that it would be met with termination and not just compulsory retirement, which would be mitigation of the punishment which was awarded by the IC. So these are a few of the sessions that we had done previously which involved judgments. And of course, this is apart from the fact that we had spoken quite extensively about compliance and investigation, and also a session dedicated towards bias in sexual harassment complaints and other issues relating to the implementation of POSH laws. Today, we have a judgment which is on unfair treatment and external member. This is, in fact, one of the latest judgments of Supreme Court, which was decided on 25th of February this year itself. And this judgment is Punjab Sind Bank versus Durgesh Kuwar. Now, the facts of the case are Durgesh Kuwar had joined as a bank officer in 1998 and was promoted to the chief manager's position, which is a scale 4 position. Between 2011 and 2017, Durgesh was quite extensively transferred from Indore to Bombay to another branch and some more branches, but had managed to stick around primarily in Bombay and Indore. And she received a transfer order sometime in December 2017, transferring her from Indore to a place, Jabalpur, which was not at par position for her. It was a position which was fit for a scale 1 officer. So it appeared that the transfer order was malafide, and it was basically demoting her from a scale 4 position to a scale 1 position. And this, in fact, was challenged by her internally. And what came out was when she had submitted her challenge regarding it, she said that the transfer order seems to be wrong because she's being sent to a scale 1 position from scale 4, which is a demotion sort of. And it was in violation of the transfer policy in the bank for women officers specifically. And she submitted this to the zonal officer, but no action was taken. Then she submitted few representations to the executive officers of the bank. In those representations, she mentioned that she, since 2016, she had been observing a lot of irregularities which were coming up in the accounts of the bank. She had seen that contractors and liquor licenses were passed out and no bank guarantees were being taken. And she had seen a lot of irregularities which had been brought to the notice of the zonal manager. But the zonal manager did not take any action on those irregularities. In fact, he harassed her by telling her to visit his place without any reason, to visit him without any official purpose, to keep on shuffling between Indore and wherever she was living in the area. And she mentioned in those executive the representations which she made to the executive office that she was being sexually harassed by the zonal manager. So she also filed a writ petition before the Madhya Pradesh High Court challenging this December 2017 order. And the court, generally speaking, under the service law provisions, it is said that a transfer is an incident of service, and it cannot be. And if an employer transfers an employee, it cannot be challenged unless it is shown that it was out of vicious intentions, malafide intentions, and it was arbitrary in nature. It was in violation of the policy. And this is what the High Court saw. The single bench of the High Court said that yes, it was in violation of the policies of the bank. The division bench affirmed it. And this was ultimately, including the issue about the sexual harassment, was put the bank challenged the High Court's order before the Supreme Court. Now, the Supreme Court on the issue of sexual harassment went about this way. So what happened in this matter was the IC did take up the case. Based on the representations made to the executive orders, the matter was forwarded up to the internal committee. However, Durgesh pointed out fallacies in the constitution of the internal committee, two of which were, one were being the presiding officer was related to a person who was responsible for the transfer order which she had challenged, and two being the external member was not really an independent external member, and she happened to be a panel lawyer for the bank. That means that the external member which we see over here was Seema Gupta. She was already doing a lot of work for the bank because of being empaneled with them. So she was aware of the bank people. She was aware of how the bank functioned. So it cannot be said that this person was completely independent and this person was not aware of the people around in the bank and the employees of the bank. So this was something that Durgesh Kumar raised an eyebrow towards and said that no, this needs to be rectified. However, the bank did not agree to it, and she in fact refused to attend these hearings, and she also went to the local committee filing a case over there, and the bank did not attend the local committee hearings. So what the court held over here was they said that there was no reason for the bank to not take into her account her request to remove the external member and replace that person with a truly independent external member, because the facet of the IC is that it has to be composed of certain people which are prescribing with the tenets of the law. And the external member's tenet of the law is that that person needs to be completely independent so that the committee can do its complaint mechanism and the complaint redressal in a proper manner. Then the court further held that these she did not attend the IC hearings. The bank did not attend the LC hearings. There was a disconnect over here, but it cannot be ignored that the IC itself was not properly formed. And what the bank's counsel tried to argue in this matter was that the IC was properly formed and there was no need for the local committee to get into it. And the person they had found no merit into the substance of the claim. So this was something that the court said that this is something that they went a layer beyond and said that the transfer order is only interfered with when there is a violation of the policy and when there's an arbitrary action, there's a violative action. And what they said was, over here, they pierced through the transfer order, and it appeared that sexual harassment was linked to the transfer order. And when she tried to point out the irregularities in the bank's functioning, is when she was harassed, and then she was transferred. So it was, making such a kind of a work environment for her. Where for raising her, for raising bank issues, she was sexually harassed, and then being transferred was suborned to the dignity of a woman who's aggrieved by the unfair treatment at her workplace. So this is something that the Supreme Court said that, this is completely attacking her dignity, not allowing her to work in a proper, conducive environment, making the environment quite hostile for her, and by transferring her, which was completely ridden of mal fide practice, is something that the court said that is cannot be tolerated. And in fact, they ordered that she be retained in the Indore branch as a scale 4 officer for a period of 1 year, and after a period of 1 year, she can be transferred as per the rules and regulations of the bank. And in fact, the court also ordered 50,000 in costs to be paid to Durgesh in this matter. So when we see this, the crux of this whole issue was about of course, transfer order was something which was service law related, not really posh law related, but it was because she didn't, she raised certain issues at the bank, it was more like a counter attack to her, and more like a counter attack for raising sexual harassment allegations against the zonal officer for harassing her, for raising issues against the bank. And in this, these things have to be very sensitively, very properly dealt with, not done by the IC, which was not comprising of, which was not fully constituted properly, not comprising of a truly independent external member. This is where we revisit the section of the external member, which talks about how this person has to be from an NGO or associations committed to the cause of women, or familiar with the issues of sexual harassment. And definitely not something that is written over here, but what we've seen from various cases previously also, in fact, the Ruchika Singh case versus Air France, where we saw that the external member is a very key person in these hearings and has to be independent because they are driving the neutrality of the entire proceeding. They are driving to the impartiality in the entire proceeding and cannot be affiliated to the employer in any manner, because that would mean that the external member can be influenced, and that would mean that the external member, the role cast on that external member is defeated by, you know, this external member actually being affiliated to the employer. Pallavi, you're on mute.
That raises a very important question and concern here, Suruchi, that when you're choosing an external member, right, how familiar should that external member be, or how distant that external member should be? Recently, we were part of an investigation where the external member is an ex-employee of that organization. So according to the organization, that person technically is not getting, is not an employee of the company anymore. And that person has now experience in the posh area also. And that person does qualify, you know, being committed to the cause of women and familiar with the issues of sexual harassment. But the technicality here, that how biased or unbiased that person will be, is no, is not written anywhere in the law.
Correct. Yes.
And that person continues. And every time that individual speaks in that investigation, you know, there's a reference of, I have known so-and-so organization for so many years. You know,
absolutely.
I understand the tolerance stand. I understand how rigid the organization is when it comes to any instances of, you know, misconduct. Is it, and there's no white and black answer, right? But there is a certain question on the impartiality of the external member at this point in time, because having worked with a specific organization for so many years, somewhere the inclination does work and the loyalty does work toward the organization. It's a different thing that, yes, as an individual, that person has been making the most of the impartial statements. There is no partiality in the statement that has come out. But there is a certain question on that that might be brought up if ever these matters go for appeal. What's your take on this? I mean, I'm not making it an interview, but just a general observation of pattern around companies that we have been observing.
No, absolutely. And I think you're right. This is quite a peculiar situation, right? I mean, there is always, companies feel there's always comfort in still knowing the external member and somebody who knows the bank. I think this is exactly what have happened in this matter, where Seema Gupta, being a panel lawyer for the bank, must have had like some level of comfort with the, she's still independent, right? She's still, she's not an employee of the bank, but she's just a lawyer working, and she could have had the knowledge of, you know, sexual harassment cases, but she's not really independent, because if she's handling bank's other matters, so, you know, she's dealing with every other employee. So she knows the ins and out of the bank. And when we go for an external member, we have to keep in mind that we cannot take somebody who knows the ins and out of the organization in any manner, because then apart from just being an employee or not an employee, what distinguishes, right? Yeah. So this is where organizations need to bear in mind that when they're selecting an external member, comfort and familiarity is something that they should keep, in fact, count. It's supposed to be kept away from, even if they may have, you know, all the requisite skill set. But they need the independence and complete, you know, unfamiliarity, if I may say so, is something that needs to be looked at apart from, of course, the proper qualifications of a person. And I think so many companies that we have seen go somewhere, you know, waver along this, that they don't realize that this is what they need to do when they hire people whom they know, and they're like, okay, now why don't you come on board as an external member? You know a few posh cases, you've done a few certificate programs, or you've done this. But if they know each other, then, you know, they're still like subject to you know, bias somewhere seeping in. So this is something that needs to be consciously stopped.
Yeah, I think that's one big gray area.
Where
the companies will still need to keep the personal preference aside. The familiarity with industry, yes, but the familiarity with organization is something, especially for a former employee or somebody who is still associated with the organization in one way or the other, except for posh-related activities, is something which will make it really difficult to remain impartial. Yeah.
Absolutely. That's very true. And also, I think from Ruchika Singh's case, the Air France case, we had got to know that, you know, if you cannot even prove impartiality, you cannot prove independence, then best not take that risk, even if the person may be known to you, or even if the person may have quite a reputation. Because what we saw in that case was that person was a well-known labor lawyer, but the person couldn't show that he was not associated, or the company couldn't show that he was not associated with even the association, like the employers association or the union of employers. So best not take that risk, you know, and become one of these cases, as we always tell them. And this is, of course, a very gray area, all of these selections, and better judgment from all these judicial precedents should only follow.
I know. That reminds me of another funny question. Funny is a wrong word, but a question that came across our way, wherein the experience or expertise of the external member in the area of posh practice. So the company actually asked that, when that person joined, they did not have any experience, but in the past 2 years, they have had the experience for working on the cases in the organization. So now, can they qualify as having experience? So 2 years ago, when they joined as an external member, there was no experience of handling any case in the area of posh. But now, after 2 years, they have handled a couple of cases. So will the law still question the experience part of it, which is once again a legit query, right?
Yeah.
When do you say that the person doesn't have experience?
Yeah, I don't know that. That's true. I mean, it sounds very familiar to like an issue of intern requiring 5 years of experience, or a fresher position requiring 5 years of experience. So If they can show some, if when they were hired or engaged as a, you know, an external member, if they can show some proof of having dealt with this law, written about this law.
Or knowledge, or, for that matter, right?
Knowledge, exactly. You just need knowledge over here, right? You need to be dealing with this law. You could have just written about it, probably conducted a lecture or a webinar on it, or have just, you know, been interviewed about it, or have, attended a few courses on it. Knowledge is key over here. Experience is not something that has been mentioned over here also, right? In the section, it says that a person familiar with the issues of sexual harassment. Now, familiarity can also come through taking courses or taking knowledge, taking webinars. But as long as, there is some familiarity now, If there is no zero familiarity, if we are working on other hardcore matters, that doesn't mean that we are familiar with the issues. But also, I mean, you have to see how consistent has this familiarity been, and how much have they worked upon gaining this familiarity. And is it like just a one-time webinar on sexual harassment laws, and you cannot just say that, oh, you're an external member.
Yeah, like, I think that's one big vague area on the knowledge anyway that this industry is struggling with.
Exactly. That's also somebody who can show that they have been quite consistent with their efforts in dealing with these issues, then I think even if they do not have too much of an experience, or you know, are taken on board without any experience, I think it should be okay, because this is something that all of us have. One day we would have begun with nothing, right? And after doing a couple of matters, or after doing a couple of advisory work, then we would have become more familiar with the issues of this law. So this is where I think we would have to work around with.
That's true.
Okay, so moving on, I think this is a very common thing which comes up in most of the cases, and also a query as to if a posh law matter is going on, other matters, other trials, other issues, say for instance, a criminal trial or any other thing should not go on. So today we'll revisit again Saurabh Kumar Malik's judgment, which we had done in our first session in July. This is the Saurabh Kumar Malik judgment, Saurabh Kumar Malik versus Comptroller and Auditor General of India, High Court of Delhi judgment of 2008. This was basically, there was a different relationship which was brought up in the complaint. The judgment also was that the person, the complainant happens to be a senior member of the National Academy of Audit and Accounts. She was Indian Audit and Accounts Service officer, and so was Saurabh Kumar Malik, who is the petitioner in this case, and he was the respondent in the posh complaint. And they all were staying at the National Academy of Accounts and Audit. And in March 2007, they had all gone out for an official dinner, and they were returning back to the academy premises, where they all were staying in the officers' mess over there. Around 11:30, they must have returned. The petitioner, Saurabh Kumar Malik, and the senior lady officer over here, they proceeded to go to their room, which was in the same residential building, the same officers' mess. And what happened was, the petitioner over here followed the senior officer and in fact entered her room and held her hands and expressed a lot of love for her. Because she felt like this was invasion of her privacy, and this was not something that she wanted, she pushed him away and pushed him out of the door. And he stood outside for a while wanting to speak with her. She called a few other officers and she asked them to take him away. The very next day, she went ahead and filed a FIR against him at the local police station. And then eventually in April, a few days later, she also filed a sexual harassment complaint against him with the disciplinary authorities over there. Now, taking into account the pending FIR against him, he was suspended from services. And they also issued him a charge sheet. The disciplinary authority also issued him a charge sheet and asked him to submit his defense after he gave them his response. But he contested that the proceedings were not as per the law, as per the service rules, and filed a petition at the Central Administrative Tribunal to stay the disciplinary proceedings while the FIR investigation was pending. So in our previous session, we had seen an argument which he had laid down regarding the officer's mess, the residential building where they stayed in the academy, could not be a workplace because it was not somewhere where they worked. In very plain, simple terms, is something that these people had argued. But the court struck down that argument and said that no, the vicinity, the officer's mess being in close proximity to the academy and also being under the control of the employer, because they would decide who would stay in the residential mess, right? So they said that no, this is a workplace. In fact, it's an extended workplace, and any incident happening over here is to be considered as an incident happening at the workplace. another argument, which is what we're going to be seeing today, is that whether there should be a stay in the departmental proceedings during the pendency of the criminal case. It could be a converse situation also, where the complaint was filed first and then the FIR. Over here, it was the FIR first and then the Porsche complaint was filed later. And this is something that the court said, that the sexual harassment is, proceeding, the complaint proceeding, is an internal disciplinary proceeding, whereas the FIR investigation on the same issue of sexual harassment is a criminal trial proceeding and is basically for trespassing and outraging the modesty of the woman employee. And what their court went ahead and spoke about, this was in 2008, of course, this is a very, this has been repeated and reiterated in a lot of judgments, even later on and prior to it. The standard of proof in a Porsche proceeding is preponderance of probabilities, whereas a standard of proof in a criminal trial is beyond reasonable doubt. Because of these trials being very clearly different in nature, the internal disciplinary proceeding happens with a mechanism under the service rules or the Porsche law. This time there was no Porsche law in this case, of course, but there was the service rules internal disciplinary mechanism. And the criminal proceedings happen as per the procedure laid down under the criminal procedure code and on the offense of what has occurred in the IPC. Because of these difference in proceedings, and the outcomes would also be different, it is likely that one outcome could be different from the other outcome. But if in a disciplinary proceeding he has been found to be for doing acts of sexual harassment based on the evidence found on grounds of preponderance of probabilities, then the outcome would be different in that matter. Therefore, the court clarified that both proceedings run parallelly, run simultaneously, and their outcomes are different, and the appeal mechanism against each outcome could also be different. So this is what the High Court said in the matter of the FIR proceeding as well as the internal committee proceeding, that they both would run parallelly. And the decision of the High Court, and something that we had discussed in our July session also, was that because he had approached the court during the pendency of the inquiry committee itself, the matter would go back to the inquiry committee and it would continue with them. And if in case the report has to be challenged, then that is a separate challenge overall and can be raised later on at any stage. However, with regards to the issue of workplace, that was sorted. And with regards to the issue of disciplinary hearings and parallel proceeding with the FIR continuing, the court answered in affirmative. They said that, yes, it can continue. And this brings us to a very a section of the law which sometimes we do not see, we do not understand. The Act very clearly specifies that the provisions of this Act are in addition to and not in derogation of any other provisions. So if sexual harassment, say for instance, has been alleged under IT Act, the Information Technology Act, or in the Indecent Representation of Women Act, or any other law, IPC, they all can run parallelly as per the procedures laid down under them, as per the procedure under, and criminal trial and civil trial being a very different kind of trial and requiring very different standard of evidence will always run parallel, and the complainant in these cases always has recourse to both the proceedings, and they are mutually exclusive to each other. They are not they don't supersede each other, neither do they cancel each other out. Pallavi, any thoughts over here?
Not really, Suruji. I think everything is covered.
Great. Super. So moving on, another transfer case actually. And this time it was a transfer as an interim measure. Now we know that the internal committee has the power to, on the request of an aggrieved woman under the law, the internal committee has the power to recommend interim measures just to make sure that the complainant and the respondent, sometimes are in front of each other, that could lead to more grievances that would lead to more animosity. So to not sabotage the inquiry, also interim measures are generally recommended by the internal committee. One of the recommendations was a transfer in this case of Dinesh Chandra Mishra versus Trilochan Mohapatra. It's another Delhi High Court judgment and is of last year, July last year. In this case, Dinesh Chandra, the petitioner over here, was an employee of the National Bureau of Plant Genetic Resources and was posted at New Delhi. By an order of transfer of 2014, he was transferred to Srinagar, which he challenged in the High Court. And the High Court, the matter came up sometime in 2017. So the High Court let him be in Delhi because the matter had come up quite late. They said that, okay, it's been almost 3 years to this issue. So let him be in Delhi. And the next time he is supposed to be transferred, let him be transferred to any other location, keeping the qualifications and area of work into account. Now, soon after this judgment happened, this order of the Delhi High Court came out, he was transferred, in fact, from his headquarters in New Delhi to a farm, Isapur farm in New Delhi itself, on account of an ongoing sexual harassment complaint against him. He now challenged this transfer order, saying that it was in contempt of the earlier order of the High Court, which said that he should be transferred to any other location, only keeping in mind his qualifications and area of work. He said that by transferring him to the Isapur farm in New Delhi, that's a farm and he works in a headquarters lab, this is not keeping in mind in his qualifications and this is not keeping in mind his area of work. However, the court struck down these arguments and they said that it appears from the email which was exchanged between the Women's Complaint Committee of the organization with the complainant, it appeared that there was a threat that this person could harm anybody and the complainant was feeling scared and threatened. So the complainant requested for an action to be taken for this person to be the complainant to be safeguarded in any manner the internal committee could. So therefore, the Women Complaint Committee suggested to the Welfare Committee saying that he may be transferred. Based on this, the transfer order of 2018 was issued. So over here, the court said that this was a power vested in the IC to take care of complaints, to take care of complaints, do not get sabotaged, do not get threatened, the complainant is not threatened, their security is taken care of, especially if they have requested for it, they have to provide an immediate relief if they feel that their life is under threat or if they do not feel comfortable with the presence of respondent not being, presence of respondent being around them will keep them in a bad position. Mentally or physically, then IC has to take these actions. And taking this action of transferring him to a few kilometers in the same area was nothing mala fide, was not a disobedience of the court's order. In fact, the court's order was that he could be transferred to any other location, but keeping in mind his area and qualifications of work. And something that was not being able to prove in, by this petitioner was that, was it really mala fide, that was it not keeping into account his area of work and qualifications? So over here, the court said that it is the right of the employer to transfer the employee who is facing an inquiry. And in fact, they went on and said that the IC is not even dependent upon such a request being made by the complainant. While there was a request made by the complainant, the court went on to say that it's not dependent. That means how we would interpret this judgment also to a certain extent would be if the IC in their discretion feel that the atmosphere, the environment at the workplace could get hostile if the complainant and the respondent are kept together in the same department or kept together in the same building, then in their fairness, they can probably approach this topic with the complainant and see if they need any interim relief, or in their fairness, they can use this discretion to advise the employer that certain measures can be taken place to make sure that the complaint goes on smoothly and during the pendency as much as peace can be maintained, that much the IC can try to endeavor to do. So this was something that was upheld, that this transfer order was not against the High Court's previous order. In fact, the petitioner over here went on to say that he has already apologized for his conduct, and the proceeding should be dropped on account of his apology. And the court said that just because a person has apologized for their conduct without the committee even completing the inquiry is not really a logical conclusion for the inquiry to be dropped. And the inquiry will continue as per the procedure, and an appropriate action as per the investigation would be recommended to the employer. So the court ultimately dismissed the petition of Dinesh Chandra and said that there was no infirmity in the transfer order issued as an interim relief by the complaints committee. We'll just revisit the section 12, which is the action during the pendency of the inquiry, and why we have highlighted over here on a written request, because although that's the letter of the law, clearly the spirit of the law which has been interpreted by the committee over here is that there does not even need to be any certain request, but it could be on the discretion of the IC, keeping into account certain maybe behavioral issues going on between the parties, or to prevent any sabotage of the peace of the environment. And the powers that is, and the recommendation that it can do is transfer either party to any other workplace, give leave to the aggrieved women for a period of 3 months, or grant any other relief. And this leave, in fact, would be in addition to whatever leave is there for her, to her credit in the account, in the management system. And also, they should be, these recommendations are to be implemented by the employer, and the IC has the discretion to even stop the respondent from reporting on the work performance of the aggrieved woman, or writing any report on the performance or the appraisal of the aggrieved woman, or even restraining them from supervising any activity of them. So these are a few of the relief that the IC can give, and something that we see from this judgment very uniquely is that it doesn't even need to be requested. It can come from the IC itself, taking into account the situation.
Very important aspect to identify here, no, Suruchi?
Yes, that, absolutely.
A lot of times committees wait for the person to actually ask for any of the interim measure. That
exactly.
If they had any problem, why didn't she ask for it? Or why didn't she say that she wants to go on a leave? And in practical sense, a lot of committees are concerned that if they will tell the complainant or the aggrieved that you have these options to choose from, what if the complainant wants a 3 months paid leave? What if the complainant demands something which is just very, random and arbitrary?
Absolutely.
It's very important to know that it's at the discretion of the committee. You have to, and the discretion of the committee has to work in the best interest of the aggrieved at that point in time. It's not a demand that can be made. It's up to, and that up to could amount, keeping in mind the kind of trauma that the aggrieved has faced, the kind of close proximity that they are working together in, the kind of work environment that she is stepping into, and so many other things. I mean, during this whole lockdown period, the investigations wherein we have been part of and we are observing and advising on, we have observed that the paid leave part is something which is not required in majority of the cases. A division of responsibility or a small break has been part of it, because now you're not walking into the same floor. But at the same time, if there's a reporting structure, that needs to be divided.
Divided, yes.
If you're part of the same WhatsApp official group, that needs to be changed. If you're part of the same Zoom meetings, that needs to change. If you have to interact on a day-to-day basis, that needs to be changed. These are the changes that needs to be done. And that's what the committees have to think like, and they have to understand that work for the interest of taking care of immediate needs of the aggrieved at that point in time. I have a few more points to make, but Arushi, you want to say something? Please,
yeah.
Thank you. I'm so sorry. I was so late for it. I could only catch up the last part, and that was also so informative, actually. I am looking forward to seeing the whole thing all together. But mine, I had a question beforehand. It started, you know, as a young law practitioner. So I had like, when people do ask you to chair the ICC, you know, because they need an external member and lawyers are the preferred choice, I feel. So it's a practical question. It's not related to this, but I guess
sure.
I haven't found a satisfactory answer to this. So this is a monetary issue. When they ask you to raise your financial, and then you're like, when, how do you, you know, price this thing? Do you price it like according to a retainer, or do you price it like, you know, when there is a inquiry or something?
Sure. So we'll definitely take this up. Just give us a couple of minutes so that I can cut the learning part, and then I will just stop, move on to the next.
Did I come in between? Was a thought I heard my name? I'm
so sorry. No. Of course you did.
I was talking
on the case related question.
Okay.
So just give me a second.